I'll be co-presenting with my colleague, Karen Keith. We'll be talking today about a tool that we're building that enables us to build ontologies. So this is me in this picture in the center, and the center of the chasm of semantic despair. So I'm a biologist, and I work at OHSU in a group where we are trying to aggregate data across this translational divide, where we're aggregating data from basic science research and clinical practice in order to make it more interoperable. And we are faced with a lot of challenges with making data interoperable because in basic science and clinical practice, there's a little overlap with the kinds of data that are produced, the reasons why they are produced, and the ways in which they are modeled. So we are trying to create efforts to align these disparate types of data to make them more interoperable, discoverable, and reusable by building ontologies to structure this knowledge. So what are ontologies? So an ontology is defined as, or can be defined as, a knowledge classification comprised of terms that are formally defined and logically related. So to give you an example of ontology, say we were going to create an ontology around a particular domain or knowledge base. Let's use the example with beer. So if we had an ontology of beer would be our upper level class, and then we would have subtypes of beer. So ontologies use a subclass classification where a light beer is a type of beer, or a dark beer is a type of beer, and then you have other subclasses of each upper level class. So we have types of light beer, could be pilsners and lagers, and a type of dark beer could be a porter or a stout. So this is just a very simple example of a type of ontology. I don't know of a beer ontology that actually exists, but using our tool, perhaps you can build one. So ontologies are used in many different applications, anything from Amazon to shop for books and other types of items, or to structure ecology data sets to describe the actual Amazon rainforest. So ontologies are expressed in a formal language. One example of this is the web ontology language, which uses the acronym OWL and not OL. And when asked why this is, they said, why not be inconsistent in at least one aspect of language, which is all about consistency? So using the OWL language, we can model ontologies using complex logic. And this is a reference to a talk yesterday where they discussed an ontology about swans, coined as the swantology. So if I wanted to make a swantology, I could model the domain of swans using this logic and relationships between the classes of swans. So I could use the NCBI taxonomy to classify the different types of swans, like swans are a type of birds, and there's different subclasses of swans, like tender swans and black swans. And then we can relate the swans to different types of anatomical features that they have using the Uber anatomy ontology known as Uberon. So swans have web feet that are capable of biological processes like swimming behavior. So this is just an example of the complex logic that's used to model ontologies, and this logic is modeled using ontology languages like OWL. So ontologies can be used to integrate diverse data sets post hoc. So this is an example of some of the work that we do in our group at OHSU, where we try to aggregate data about model organs and databases for informing rare disease diagnoses. So we take diverse data sets, such as genes or mechanisms and phenotypes, and then the data sets are annotated to, the data sets come from disparate sources, and then are annotated to disparate ontologies. And we've created these unifying ontologies that can aggregate these annotated data, and then we can take this data corpus and analyze it with various tools that we have that are part of our project, the Monarch Initiative. But one of the biggest challenges with using ontologies and building ontologies is that there's a really steep learning curve for building ontologies. So a lot of ontology development requires specialized tools and expertise in order to build the ontologies. So it makes it less accessible for domain experts to be able to contribute to ontologies. A lot of times domain experts are the people that we need to be creating ontologies because they understand the domain in a lot of cases better than the actual ontology builders. So we want domain experts to be able to contribute to and develop ontologies, but we need to provide tools to the community that are easier to use than a lot of tools that are currently available. available. So as part of our project, we are trying to build a new type of ontology tool, which currently is under development and doesn't have a proper name yet. So we're calling it the table editor for now. If anyone has any suggestions, we're open to suggestions. And so we want the table editor to allow users to express their concepts easily without having to use these current tools that are available that are difficult to learn to use and to implement. We want the table editor to be familiar and easy to use, so table-based editing or spreadsheet format is accessible for most people. And we want the table editor to ensure output of clean link data in a standardized format. So I'm going to share some features with you about the table editor. Like I said, it's still under development, so it's not quite available in its full functionality yet. But some of the features that we are building into it are, it will be deployed as a static website, so it'll be available online, where anyone can go and access it. They can view and edit it online in a spreadsheet formatted, data. And it'll also integrate underlying ontologies, so users can autocomplete and select from the semantically associated ontologies and dictionaries. It'll be support the formats both tab-separated values and comma-separated values, which in the software and documentation will be collectively referred to as an CSV file. And the complexity of the ontology logic will be captured by using these new patterns, which we're calling dead simple ontology design patterns. And like OWL, the acronym is backwards. It's also developed by our colleague David of Sydney Sutherland, so his initials are also integrated into our acronym. So using the dead simple design patterns, these allow us to specify the OWL design patterns behind the scenes, and then be integrated into the spreadsheet, which I'll show you shortly. But the patterns are in a YAML format that can be converted to JSON. And we can use these patterns to generate documentation about how the logical definitions should be written for specific classes of terms. We can use it to generate new terms. So if we have a class of terms like abnormal or morphology, we can have one pattern and then quickly generate new terms using these patterns. We can also retrofit old terms. One of our aims in our ontology development in our unified ontologies is to try to have interoperability between the ontologies. So these patterns can be used to retrofit terms to make the ontologies consistent and aligned with each other. And also, once we have a pattern, we can use this, we can reuse the pattern to other ontologies, again, to make the ontologies aligned and consistent. So I'll give you an example of how we can use these design patterns to create an ontology. So let's pretend we're still working on our bear ontology. So if we're building a bear ontology, we'd want to classify different types of bears that exist in the world. So let's start by building one class of bear. So in an ontology, we always have a name for the class. We define the class textually and logically. So if we have to name a beer, my favorite beer is India Pale Ale, so that will be the name that we'll use, and it'll have the synonym IPA, which is more commonly known by. Give it a text definition, which is just the definition I got from Wikipedia, which is a hoppy beer within the broader category of a pale ale. But if we wanted to logically define the attributes of an IPA, we would logically define the class using terms from other ontologies or other ontological terms. So in the boxes here, I have listed some different attributes for other ontologies or other ontology classes that we could use to logically define the beer. So I want to ask you, the audience, how would you logically define an IPA? So picking one term from each of these lists, which ones would you say? So IPA has which color?
Pale.
Pale. Good. And IBUs, any idea? IPAs are hoppy, so the higher the IBUs, more bitter.
In Portland, 80 to 100.
Yeah.
Just saying.
Yeah, so for one source, I read it said 60 to 80.
Right.
Yeah, maybe the double IPAs would be 80 to 100. And does anyone know what type of yeast IPAs use? They use a Saccharomyces cerevisiae. So in our logical definition, we would use these ontology terms to build a logical definition. And we'll show you that the table editor will let you pick from a list of these terms in order to easily build the logical definitions without knowing the actual OWL language. But what if we needed to add some other attributes to define our beers? So beers aren't only defined by color and yeast and IBUs. Especially if you're drinking the Beard beer, which is brewed by Rogue Brewery here in Oregon, which actually contains yeast that was found within the brewmaster's beard. So in the Beard beer, we had to classify this beer by the color, which is a pale ale. It's apparently not a very hoppy beer. It has IBUs of 15 to 25. It's brewed from beer yeast, and it contains an anatomical feature, which you may not normally think to include in your beer, but in this case, you have to include that it comes from the beer. So if you want to try the beer, it's available from Rogue, which they have a pub just down the street here. So the table editor will look something like this, where the users will be, they'll be on a website. The users will be able to go into the website and the names of their beers or whatever classes they want to include. And then they'll be able to go to a pick list, and the terms will be constrained by the design patterns. So if you want to add the color to the beer, you'll be constrained to the colors that are included by the patterns. So in our cases, we have pale or dark or other types of patterns that I, or choices that I included above. You can specify the taxonomy, so it comes from these different types of yeast strains that are used to ferment the beer. And in this case, if we have a beer, it includes an anatomical feature. So this is a very simple table editor that the users will use. And then the design patterns in the background will generate the ontology classes from the spreadsheet. So we have the structured code in the background, and this is what the ontology model would look like. So we have beer classified as an American wild ale, which is a type of pale ale. We have colors coming from the quality ontology, PAITO, which is phenotypic attributes ontology. So the colors are coming from another ontology. We can include different yeast strains from the MCDI taxonomy, etc. So this is what the actual mapping looks like for the patterns. So we can build these patterns to specify different types of classes of terms, and then this is what will run in the background of the table editor, and the users will just see the table editor. But these patterns will drive the classification and the development of the ontology terms and definitions. So let's go through the pattern. So we have a pattern name, give every pattern name. This would be a beer type pattern. So we specify the classes that are used to build the logical definitions. So we have colors and bitterness, yeast strains and anatomical entities coming from these different ontologies. We define the relationships between these terms. And then we have different variables that we can use to build the patterns. And then we can have the patterns actually build the labels of the labels, the synonyms, and the text definitions, as well as the logical definitions. So if we had this term, this variable color, we can have it automatically create the label, which is the color in an ale, so pale ale, give it a synonym, saying, specifying that we want it to be an anatomical entity, the word ale, so we can say the synonyms to be structured like so. We can structure the text definitions by using different variables, and also we can develop the equivalence axioms based on these patterns here. And so we can use this table editor to build these patterns based on these patterns that are running in the background. And Dan here is going to talk to you about the technical architecture of how the table editor is built.
Hello. This is mostly the architectural diagram. Ultimately, the code is designed to be just a bunch of static assets, which makes it very easy to deploy and lightweight. But then the app that the user experiences pulls from various ontologies that are already in the world. In this case, I wrote those as the shared ontologies. So ultimately, the editor, the user, would either start with no original CSV, or they'd have an existing CSV, which represented their subset of the ontology. They would bring it into the table editor. They would either add rows or edit rows. And as they did that, it would be constrained by the patterns and the ontologies. And then they would emit a new data file, which would be the updated CSV. Behind the scenes, we also have the option of generating new OWL files that we can inject back into the ontologies so that the next person that comes along now sees these new classes of beers that they can then relate the stuff to. And this is just a quick demo to show that this, the code is working. In this case, I'm actually selecting from a list of patterns that are canned. I think I'm going to end up choosing the beer yeast anatomy example, which Nicole was showing. And then there's other ways to select patterns. You can have a pattern somewhere, you know, have a pattern file somewhere in GitHub, and then you can just refer to it. You can drag a pattern file from your desktop. But once you have a pattern file, that sort of sets up the columns that you have available to edit. So in this case, I've selected the beer yeast anatomy pattern, and now I'm adding a new type of beer. So I'm selecting a India Pale Ale, I'm picking yeast here, and then I'm going to pick some random anatomy part. We'll see how that works out. I think I get the internal cheek pouch. So, and then it auto labels the beer as India Pale Ale beer with Saccharomyces cerevisiae from internal cheek pouch. Beer is probably better. And then finally, when we're done, after we've added a few beers, we can then export that back to a CSV, or behind the scenes, we can take that same data and pattern and generate a an updated OWL file that we can inject into our ontology databases. And that is it for me.
So like we demonstrated here, we can use the table editor to contribute to and extend existing ontologies. So we can build these patterns so we can add new terms to ontologies based on patterns that are already used. Or we can use the table editor to create new ontologies. And we didn't show an example today, but we also can use the table editor for data curation. So we can specify different columns and then have ontology drop-down lists in different columns so you can structure, or you can map terms to ontological terms to make data more structured. And all of this is available on the GitHub site here, listed here. And I'd like to thank our team, Melissa Handel, which is you, the Dark Group, Chris Mungle and Peter Robinson are the co-PIs on the Monarch Initiative, Julian McMurray, which is you, David O'Simmons Sutherland is the one who developed the design patterns, and Jim Bellhoff has been helping with this as well. And thank you very much for listening. Please feel free to email us or tweet to us for more information. And our group may be hiring in the future, so please contact us if you're interested in working on tools like this. And just email to info@monarchinitiative.org. Thanks very much, and we'll take any questions.